please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Just below the 10,500 mark for now, but let's focus on a lot of the other news that has come through for the moment. And here's the big exclusive today. Kritika Saxena caught up with Rajesh Gopinathan, MD and CEO of TCS, and began by asking him if TCS will continue to deliver growth that is ahead of the industry average. Here's a slice of that conversation.
It depends on what the industry is. I think if you take the industry as technology services providers, we definitely are.
Yeah.
But NASSCOM now represents a much wider variety.
Yeah, yeah.
There are delivery centers of foreign companies here. There are captive units of other industries here.
Yeah.
They're all getting clubbed into a, and they're being called part of the industry. Hardly part of the industry. That's not their business.
Yeah.
So in our,
that's not the right
in our competitive
anymore?
Set, I think we are quite confident about it. The rest of it depends on company dynamics and rather than competitive dynamics. So we don't want to comment about it.
Okay, but will you be within that range or higher?
Again, as I said, I don't want to use that as a benchmark.
Okay.
It's not
fair
the
enough.
Right one.
For FY18 then, Rajesh, what is the outlook like? You're ending on a positive note. In terms of the scale and the deal momentum, are things looking better as you go into FY19? Is FY19 looking like a better year than FY18?
So every time, around this time of the year, you ask that
I
question.
Always ask you if the next coming year is going to be better. And so, you often do give an answer, Rajesh.
Yeah, okay. I need to be more careful than that then. See, the momentum is there, as you've clearly seen from the deal side of it. And from an industry perspective, various industry groups are coming together. We have called out the bottoming out in retail.
Yeah.
And as you've seen, some of the deals are coming from
and
that
And you've
space.
Said the big challenge, that is BFSI, another 2 quarters left and that should start getting better.
I think so. We are much more constructive on insurance as we see this. And banking and is still an area that's work in progress. And we need to see how that turns out. So, other than that, most of the other industries are actually doing quite well.
At a group level, Chandra is working on increasing synergies. As you look at going to the next level, building the scale further, how important is synergies across Tata companies, the other IT companies, the Tata Elxsi, the Tata Technologies? Have you started those synergies already with the other IT companies in the group?
I think the chairman's message on simplification and synergy and scale is very powerful.
Yeah.
And technology per se could act as the single most integrating factor across the group.
Exactly.
So there's a new chief digital officer in the group. And the thinking is also becoming much more widespread as to how do we optimize and how do we enable technology to act as a fabric that integrates across the entire group. So we are very excited about it and how do we participate in it. But it has to evolve.
How long will it take to see, get some clarity on how the synergies are going to happen across the IT companies, across the tech capabilities?
It's not really about the IT companies that the focus is. The focus is against the operating companies and how do we get together. So we have been having series of meetings with various companies. People have been coming here to Banyan, to our EBC in Banyan Park. And not just that, we are increasing our focus on trying to think as to how do we learn from the transformation agendas that we have participated in and how do we bring that to bear to companies across the full scale spectrum inside the group. So how do we make it available for relatively mid-sized companies to actually participate in the technology spectrum in a much more holistic way.
Okay. What are the chances of a big bang Tata Elxsi, TCS, Tata Technologies merger?
You should ask their shareholders.
but can it be, is that an option, looking at a merger with other IT companies?
That's
in the
not
group?
The focus of the agenda.
That isn't. Okay. Fair enough. Rajesh, let me ask you a point that I wanted to mention. You have talked about how acquisitions you will do, and even Chandra used to say this, if it fits in the right skill set or the niche capability that you need at that particular point in time. Why haven't we seen TCS be aggressive with acquisitions in the last many years?
We have been aggressive in our own forms in many ways, but as I said, the focus is the right asset at the right price point is the
Are there
key.
Assets right now that you're looking at?
There are assets of both natures. There are right assets at atrocious price points, and there are assets at the good price points, but which don't fit, fit us. So when we find the right one, we, but the important thing about TCS is whenever we have made an acquisition, okay. So our hallmark is we do a few things, but then we try to execute it exceedingly well. So whenever we have made an acquisition, we have stayed very, very focused with it, and you will see us constantly staying with it. We have not done an acquisition and then walked away from it.
Exactly.
So whether it is Japan, whether it is France, whether it is any of the other ones in the earlier times. So given that, our, what should you say, the frequency of acquisitions is going to be much more measured.
All right, then we're seeing some selling pressure actually every time the Nifty tries to bounce back. Vedanta's move lower, it's down 2.5% as we speak. But a couple of stocks are fighting, and Infosys, you know, time and again I have to pull up that stock because it's just building on, you know, it's really been the rock solid batsman in there, if I have to refer to it in cricketing parlance. It's playing a very, very good knock today, up close to around 1.8% in an otherwise very dull market. And we have some company actually, Bharti Infratel. Suddenly we're seeing that stock as well from trading with a cut of around 0.5% to 1%. It's now up close to around 0.5%. So good going over there. You pull up the intraday chart over there as well. Whoopsie. That's moved virtually to the high point of the day. But on to a quick CNBC TV eating exclusive then. We learn from sources that the SR Steel Committee of Creditors at COC are likely to meet on the 5th of March to decide on bids from New Metal as well as from ArcelorMittal. Ritu Singh joins us with all those details. Ritu.
5th of March is the D-Day for SR Steel, where both the bids that have been submitted for SR Steel will be considered and evaluated by the Committee of Creditors. Now, this will pave the way for the treatment of similar such bids for other IBC cases. Now, remember, two bids were submitted for SR Steel, one from New Metal, which comprises of VTB, a Russian bank, and Revanth Roya, which is the son of the promoter of SR Steel, that is Ravi Roya. And the second bid had come in from ArcelorMittal that had a promoter stake in Uttam Galva, that was a non-performing asset, which of course it exited later to be able to bid for SR Steel. But both of these bids have been, you know, mired in controversies. Now, how the IRP is treating them, you know, they're currently in consultation with the lawyers. They have not disqualified either of the bids and are looking to present both of them to the Committee of Creditors. Of course, a final decision on the eligibility itself will also be taken in that meeting on the 5th of March. So an important day to watch out for. The liquidation value of the company is about 20,000 crore rupees and the debt is well over 45,000 crore rupees. And it is a very closely contested match. It will be interesting to see how these bids are treated. And if ArcelorMittal will be able to pip New Metal or the other way around to acquire this asset.
All right, Ritu, thanks very much for that. Well, that's certainly a story that will have a lot of interest as we run up to the 5th. But let's talk about some companies from the IT space then, because that's really been a big pillar of support for the market. So to take stock of what's happening on the ground, we caught up earlier this morning with Rostro Ravanan, MD and CEO of Mindtree, and S. Sri Krishna, CEO of Hexaware Technologies, to hear what's really happening on the ground.
Based on what we are hearing from the customers and what we are hearing from the analysts that track us, I think there's a few changes that are very positive for Mindtree. One is customers are now beginning to appreciate capability more than only capacity. So the size of the vendor is not that much of an importance to the customer anymore. But do you have the right capability? Do you have the right experts who can solve the problem most efficiently for the customer? That's becoming a bigger priority, and that's becoming our sweet spot, because we had invested in building capability in our chosen areas over the last 3 or 4 years, and the market is turning towards those sweet spots, and we are well positioned to service our customers.
We expect to continue industry-leading growth. It means that we have a solid order book on the basis of which we've given a projection and guidance. Usually our guidance for the year does not, you know, is based on what orders have already come in 2017. That's the basis of guidance for 18. It doesn't depend a lot on orders during 2018. It does a little bit, and our pipeline is very good. But whether or not we win deals in 2018 is not going to impact our growth during the year. We feel very good and confident about maintaining our industry-leading growth. The client-specific issues are well and truly in our rear-view mirror.
Well, the equity market, the key indices down about 0.5%. Just not the day to be an investor in banking stocks. But let's take stock of what's happening in the commodity space then. We're missing Manisha Gupta, but we have Dharmesh Bhatia with us. Hi, Dharmesh. Good afternoon. First up, could you give us a sense of, you know, what's happening on the currency front? Do you have a strategy for the dollar INR?
Good afternoon. Yes, I'm expecting the rupee to depreciate a little bit because I'm really bullish on the dollar index. I'm expecting the dollar index to bounce back. It's almost trading was a 3 years low and bounced back to almost 90 level plus. If you have noticed, other currencies like euro and sterling both has depreciated overnight. So this will trigger a ripple effect on the INR also. And you can see INR heading towards the previous low of around 65.30 to 65.40 level mark, which is a really crucial level. At that time, you can book profit. But currently, I'm expecting the dollar to get further from this.
Okay, all right. Dharmesh, what about crude and gold? If you could give us your strategy on both those two.
For short term, I'm expecting the crude to show some kind of profit breaking at the higher levels. Right now, the market is really in a consolidation phase. Price has already tanked 8 to 9% from the top. March OPEC meeting is there. You can see a further drag down to the price because they will expect the price to be firm further. But again, the shale production and the U.S. inventory is really high, which will actually pushing the price at lower belt. So around 60-61 level in the market, we were consolidated in domestic market just because of rupee getting depreciated. You can see the gold is holding, crude is holding above 4,000 level mark, but I'm expecting the market to breach the March expiry. So I would suggest you any speculative lies a good level to accumulate short for crude for short term.
Okay, and Dharmesh, anything on precious metals, gold, silver?
For precious metals, if you see the king, the bullion bike, the gold is really in a very range-bound moment. It's not able to go below 1,300 and not about 1,377, which is like a Trump rally. I'm expecting the market to consolidate. Just because of rupee, again, in domestic market, price is really showing some kind of firmness. But I'm expecting that March, the market will show weakness, and you can see the gold price go way below 30,000. And with interest rate change, and the bond yield again heading towards the 10-year U.S. Treasury heading towards 3 mark, you can see the pressure in equities and gold also.
Okay, all right, Dharmesh, thanks so much for joining in and giving us all of that. Well, on that note, we'll wrap up on Halftime Report. You stay with us. Business Lunch comes up next.